played a billion times, like a blues chorus. I don't really sit down and practice, you know, too much about like predetermining what I'm going to play, because that's pretty comfortable. I've done that a billion times. It just depends on what you're giving people. So the idea of cutting little chunks out and putting stuff in. Now, how do you determine what sounds hip? You don't know what sounds hip if you haven't been listening to people that sound hip. So you should be listening to the models, and I know there's a list of recommended recordings on the handout he gave you. That's fantastic. So listening and using your ears comes from one end. The other end is the Ebersole thing, where they actually say, this is the chord, these are the options, which is genius to get you over that to that first step where you don't sound stupid. Because if you do those things, you won't play wrong notes. It also, and I think it's great, I'm not talking it down, but it can be limiting because you might not see something that somebody else is doing on an album. So you might hear things on albums and be like, that is not what he told me to play in class today. There are so many options. You can do anything. If you do it in an ordered fashion, you can do anything. Has anybody ever heard of a tritone substitution? Yeah, you heard of it? Can you explain it? Do you know what it is? Yeah. How well do you know? Just heard of it? Okay. So, if you have okay, let's put it this way. The Jamie Ebersole answer, if you say A-7, you're supposed to play over, they call it Dorian minor, right? There are other things you could play over that would sound absolutely fine. So who knows what the Ebersole answer is? Again, it's a great answer, but who knows what the Ebersole answer is for that? It's a really fun word. You go back and tell your friends and band, they'll be like, what did you say? Mixolydian, right. So Mixolydian. Basically, almost every time you see this chord, every single time you see this chord, it's going to have a flat 7. But it's
going to D flat.
Well, yeah, maybe. How do I say this? Okay, put it this way. So that's G mixolydian. Ebersole will tell you that this is the right answer. I'm not necessarily against it. Although, if somebody behind me is playing this particular chord and I sit on this C, it's actually kind of ugly. That C sounds like, if I'm in this key, that sounds like we just changed key when I get to the C at the end, right? That sounds like we went to the C. Are you with me? So if I'm staying on this chord, and I'm staying on that, if I hit the C, but everybody behind me is playing, if that chord is happening behind me and I'm sitting on, it's probably not going to sound that great. What would sound great is if I change this to this. So if the chord behind me is playing and I sit on this note, that actually can sound really hip. So if you're actually going to say I can sit on any of the notes, I don't think that's exactly the right answer. I would actually say Lydian makes a Lydian, and I don't know if I'm getting the territory. I should just gonna start moving the line.
Okay.
But my point is with this, that no matter whether there are plenty of options or you only use one option, which is what, you know, the beginning level of the Ebersole stuff is, what you can always absolutely know is true is that this chord is going to have G, B, D, and F in it. That you can always know is true, okay? That does not mean that you have to play those notes, but that means that's what the people behind you are going to play. Are we cool with that? Okay. We use a flatted seventh, because if you play your G major scale, you have an F sharp, right?
Yeah.
Everybody knows this? Okay. So we use the flatted seventh so much more frequently than we do the normal seventh, that whenever we put a seven, we just assume that it's going to be flatted. Okay? Just because it's so much more common, we actually decided that if we're going to play the normal seventh, we'll mark it. If we're not going to play the normal seventh, we'll just leave it alone. So in the key of C, if I put down C7, can somebody spell me this chord? Every other note.
C, E, A, G.
No, C, E, G.
C, E, G. W.
B-flat, right. So you can just assume, because we use them so much more with the flatted seventh, that we don't even mark it. We just put seven, okay? If you wanted a major seventh, there are a couple different ways you can write it, depending on who you are. Sometimes people put M-A-J seven. Sometimes people put C with a little triangle seven. Either one of those is kind of, those are fine and they're pretty standard. But every time you see a seven, it's going to have a flat seven. Okay? Now, figuring out what these chords mean, that's absolutely crucial. If you don't know what those chords mean when you're looking at them on the bandstand, you're not going to have a clue what the people behind you are playing, so you're not going to know what's going to sound stupid. Or you're not going to be able to write out a solo, because when I'm writing, even if you're writing out a solo, you need to know, and your ears will tell you this, like I said. It goes a little quicker if you know when you have chord sheets, right? So, if I look at a G7, I know these notes are not only what they're playing behind me, but I know those notes are safe and I'm not going to sound stupid. Now here's the thing, and this is what I basically did. This is how I kind of started when I was younger. I was listening and getting the ideas in my ear of what I thought sounded cool from listening. I had a little bit of the Ebersole thing coming in, but what I mostly did was I would figure out. I would figure out whatever notes were in the chord, and then I just put something in between them. So let's say I'm playing a C7. I know those are the notes in the chord. That's not going to change. Those are definitely going to be played behind me. Now, what the answer is, the Lydian answer, the mixolydian answer is,